have something to say. It's better to burn out than to fade away.
I'm the master of your destiny.
Highlander the movie was released in 1986 and received mixed to positive reviews. The mixed reviews came from the US critics at the time, who felt the movie was an interesting premise but was silly and boring, and they found the director's camera work off-putting. The film was poorly marketed in the US, with a terrible black and white poster with a close-up of Christopher Lambert. Anyone who saw this poster wouldn't have a clue what the film was about until they saw the trailer. The US release was cut short by 8 minutes. I don't think this really affected the film's success there, because it's not a drastic cut compared to other films. A few scenes were trimmed generally for violence, and a flashback to World War II that develops the character of Rachel was left out. The European cut remained intact. Later through the years, on Laserdisc and DVD, a director's cut was released, which was the European cut into the US market. Now, the film wasn't a huge success on release, and unfortunately didn't recoup its budget back, but became a cult classic once it hit VHS. And through the years has been increasingly popular. Once the sequel came out, the first film gained more popularity, so in the end, for the investors involved, they made a lot of money in the long term. The original story for Highlander was written by Gregory Wyden, who had come up with the idea while visiting the UK in his early 20s. His original script was a lot more serious in tone and more grittier, and many of his ideas were changed by scriptwriters Peter Bellwood and Larry Ferguson. Originally, Connor MacLeod was born in 1408 instead of 1518. He lived with his mother and father. Heather, Connor's wife in the film, didn't exist. Connor was promised to a young girl named Mara, who he loved but later rejected him because of his immortality. Connor leaves his village instead of being banished. Now, Sean Connery's character, Ramirez, was born in Spain in 1100 instead of being an ancient Egyptian, born more than 2,000 years earlier. The Kurgan was known as the Knight and was not a savage but a cold-blooded killer. Immortals could have children in the original draft, and Connor is said to have been 37, and in one scene he attends the funeral of one of his sons. There is no quickening in the first draft of the script, and nothing special occurs, and there is no mention of the prize. So the changes made to the script did add more interesting comic book style elements that actually worked really well. It would be interesting to see if they finally rebooted the franchise, with talk of a remake happening, if they actually stick to the original script by Gregory Wyden. It would be a different film altogether, which would be the right direction, because you can't really remake the first film, and the music, which I guarantee they wouldn't use, really gives the film its character and soul. In the director's chair is Russell Mulcahy, who is best known for directing some of the best music videos of the 1980s. Russell had just made Razorback, which caught the attention of the producers. Russell Mulcahy is well known for his excellent visual style and creative camera angles. Highlander has many original transitions from one scene to another, and many shots in the film incorporate low-angle shots with wide-angle lenses. Christopher Lambert was chosen for the role, I imagine, for his excellent performance in Luc Besson's Subway, and Greystoke, The Legend of Tarzan. Christopher barely knew any English when he took on the role, and had a dialogue coach on set to help him with his lines and to develop an accent that sounded non-Pacifically foreign, which was a clever move, because if someone had lived for over 400 years and in many different countries, his accent would be a sort of mixed match, which you couldn't nail down to a Pacific country. Obviously, for the start of the film where he is in Scotland, I feel he made a good effort with the accent, but you can clearly tell he's not Scottish. It's funny, really, on paper, having a Frenchman play a Scotsman and a Scotsman playing an Egyptian. You would say that's terrible casting, but the filmmakers pulled it off. And in the end, you're not caring about what country the actors are from, because you've come invested in the characters and you want to know how the story unfolds. Sean Connery does add some class to the film and gives his usual classic performance. Sean and Christopher got on so well during the making of the film, they called each other by their characters' names, even when they were not filming, and Christopher Lambert supposedly insisted Sean return for the sequel. Clancy Brown gives a great performance as the Kurgan. He nearly didn't take the role due to his allergy to the makeup involved that would prevent him from wearing the prosthetics required later on in the film. Clancy went on to appear in Starship Troopers, but he is well known for providing voices to cartoons such as Mr. Crab from SpongeBob SquarePants.
So, some trip, eh, Mr. Crab?
Oh, Squidward! You're never gonna believe it! A giant blue-lipped clam ate me dollar!
What holds this film together on an emotional level, and giving the film its epic feel, is its music by Michael Kamen and Queen. Queen had originally planned to contribute one song to the film, but after viewing a rough cut, they were inspired to write more. Each band member had a favourite scene and specifically composed songs for them. Brian May wrote Who Wants to Live Forever, and Roger Taylor used It's a Kind of Magic as the basis for the end title song. Freddie Mercury performed a brief snippet of New York, New York for one scene. The song has never been officially released as part of any Queen album or soundtrack to the film, which is a shame because he does a fantastic cover. Only one music video was produced for the film, which was Princes of the Universe, directed by Russell Mulcahy. Russell also directed It's a Kind of Magic as well, but that video wasn't associated with the film. The song's Princes of the Universe was never released as a single in the UK, but became a cult favourite due to its relation to the film. The special effects in Highlander still stand up and look good. The film mainly relies on in-camera effects. The quickening scenes are well orchestrated, especially after the first fight scene. There are some effective matte paintings that are used to extend Connor's home in Scotland. You can see the top half is a painting. There are a few glaring stunt double issues during the end battle sequence, and you can clearly see the wires holding up Christopher Lambert on the final quickening sequence. They did their best to hide the wires by animating lightning over the top. Highlander, I personally think, is a terrific movie that ticks all the right boxes to entertain anyone. It's looked upon more favourably by the general public than film critics. It's a terrible shame the first film was followed by some awful sequels. Highlander 2 practically destroyed the backstory to the first film and made up some nonsense that Connor MacLeod was from another planet. And the third film was a basic retelling of the first film. The producers involved with these films didn't have a clue what they were doing with the character and milked it for all it's worth. The first film stated there can only be one. Pretty much ties up the story, so it becomes incredibly difficult to make a sequel. I suppose looking back, they should have done a prequel set in the past. Russell Mulcahy does a splendid job at directing this film and adds some inventive camera work and gets the right people involved to give it its style and look. The Queen music really gives the film its edge over other similar genre films, and I personally don't think the film would have worked if they weren't attached. For anyone who has seen this film, I highly recommend watching it on Blu-ray, and if you haven't seen it, where have you been? You're missing out. Forget the sequels and stick to the first film. There can be only one.